Hi everyone, welcome to Surah Online. I'm Surah Swaleh, and joining me today is the incredible actress and author Miss Karyn Parsons. She's best known as Hilary Banks on The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Before I start, I just have to say Hilary had the most amazing clothes. Her wardrobe is outstanding. So I wanted to know, was it you that picked her outfits for the show, or was it the producers that picked what you're going to wear for every episode?
Well, we had a brilliant stylist, Judy Richman, who had such an eye and such a feel for every character and a real consistency. Sure, I had a little bit of a say, but it's a good thing I didn't have too much, because there were quite a few times that Judy would say, put something on me that would be, you know, three sizes too big, and kind of like seemed to me like, you know, years old and ugly, and I would go, oh God, Judy, please, why is this on me? Let's take it off. What's going on? No, just hold on, just wait a minute, Cynthia, come here. And they'd start pinning and tucking and pulling, and by, you know, a few days later when they had tailored it, it looked like a million
fantastic
bucks, you know. And she was just really brilliant that way, so I completely credit Judy.
Do you have a favorite outfit that you wore?
That's a good question. That's a really good question. You know, when it was over, I only took one thing with me. I mean, mind you, I wore things on camera as Hillary, so it wasn't like I was that enthusiastic about taking the clothes home. Felt a little bit silly. But there was one outfit that I barely wore on the show. I mean, I came on the show and I was in and out really quickly, and I loved it. It was a red pantsuit. It was like a blazer and pants, but it had asymmetrical lapels with studs, with big giant silver studs on, or like dark, they're gunmetal, like silver studs on the lapels, and then somewhere on the pant. And it was the coolest looking suit. You only saw me in for a second, so I was like, I'll take that. And that way it fit really well too. I see stuff every now and then, like on a meme or something, and I'll be like, ooh. That's cute. You know?
And I'm trying to remember what that looked like. So I'm trying to think of the episode. You said it was quick, but
it was quick. I don't remember which one it was. I don't remember. I just know that it was so fast. I felt comfortable wearing it out, you know, afterwards. Yeah.
Did you take any of them home after the show ended?
That was it. That was the only thing I took. I think that was the only thing I took. Yeah, because you have to remember, it was costume for me. They were cute clothes, but it was my costume. So it felt a little bit like costume. Yeah. Like, you know,
it should be like a museum or something. It needs to be like a museum.
Yeah, it felt very strange to go out and just try to take myself seriously out in public. Excuse me, you know, wearing that. So
I know. But speaking of the show and episodes, do you have a special favorite episode of yours, or favorite scene, or just any moment that kind of stands out when you think back to that show?
I think my favorite is still, and it might change if I go back and watch the episodes. It could certainly change, but I know when we did it, the episode in the first season where Will and Carlton blackmail Hillary, they find out she's dropped out of college, and I have to bark like a dog and do all this stuff.
Hillary.
Hillary! 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 Hillary!
Stop it! I can't take it anymore! I dropped out of school there!
That part, that was really something else. And one of the reasons was because I saw the audience's reaction to her, because it was the first season, and so she was kind of new. It was all new. And when I went to Carlton for help, and he turns on me and says, you know, will you clean mine? And the audience just started stomping in the stands. They were so excited. They weren't just clapping or cheering. They were actually stomping. They were so excited to see Hillary get hers. And I remember like trying to keep it together and not laugh through the scene, because I couldn't believe it. I was like, oh my God, they really hate her.
Oh, and this is his latest. He gave me a list of embarrassing things I have to do at dinner tomorrow night.
That's awful. Is he making you clean his room?
No.
Will you clean mine?
It was really fun. I mean, also in the Trevor proposal and Bungie scene.
Oh, yes.
was also really fun.
Oh my god.
There was a lot of things. Yeah, it was hard. It was bittersweet, you know, on Monday morning when we first read that script for the first time and we saw that this was going to happen, because, you know, it was funny and everything, but all I kept thinking is, oh my gosh, that means Brian's gone. And I loved acting with him. So it was, like I said, it was bittersweet.
So as you know, today is International Women's Day. So which females in your life would you say is your inspiration?
Oh my goodness, absolutely. I mean, my mother has been for so long. She passed a few years ago, but she still is very much, very much with me. And my daughter, who's 18, inspires me every day.
I can't believe Hillary Banks has an 18-year-old daughter. What?
I know. It's weird, right? I know.
You know, you are not just an actress. You're also a very successful author. So I was wondering, because after looking at your books, I've noticed that you like to include people who look a lot like us. So was that inclusivity due to the Black Lives Matter movement? Or was that just something that you've always had in mind to make?
Actually, that's what my work was before the movement. It was, I started an organization called Sweet Blackberry in 2005. And the whole mission was to bring little known stories of Black achievement to children, to bring stories that people were not familiar with to kids in order to, so the stories weren't lost, but also to inspire and empower them and to change the landscape of race for kids. Because as they come up, either whether it's themselves or their neighbor, that they're seeing these accomplishments they recognize themselves in or recognize their neighbor in, it changes how they value Black people and their contributions to society and what they're capable of. And they see what they are capable of because of the obstacles and hurdles that they had to go, you know, move through. And so that was work that I've been doing for a long time. My book, How High the Moon, which also takes place during the Jim Crow South in America, where the segregated South, was based loosely on my mother's upbringing in the 1940s in the segregated South. And so I deal with a lot of issues in there as well. And all of these things were before the movement really picked up. And what I've seen since, which, and it's been something that's meant a lot to me, and I've seen people respond really strongly all along to it and saying, this is important, this is great. But of course, once that happened, people really started paying more attention and saying, oh, wow, we want to see more of this. We, it became something people recognized even more urgently. It was something important that they needed to pay attention to.
You have a very successful career. And I was just wondering if in your own personal life, have you ever thought that maybe being light-skinned is a privilege and has helped you through your career? But however, because I was always told that I would never make it to interview celebrities because I'm so dark.
It's completely fair to use the word privilege, because it is. I've definitely experienced privilege being light-skinned, you know, being without a doubt. I've seen that all along. I've seen that like crazy. I mean, we've all watched it. We've seen it. And things, fortunately, we're seeing a change in things. But I've watched television and film my whole growing up. You know, I'm much older than you are. And my growing up, I watched us see, when we did see Black faces, they were predominantly light-skinned faces. You know, we saw that, and we saw the people here and there. I mean, that's one of the reasons, I mean, there are a million reasons we love Sidney Poitier, but, but I think one reason everybody just kind of was like, ah, he's so important, because he embodies so much that we all people strive for and want to be, all people of every race. But on top of it, he's a dark-skinned man, you know, and the world recognizes him. So I think, without a doubt, I think I can't deny privilege. I'm happy to say that a lot of things that I've done in my life, I feel like I've done, you know, I feel good about. I don't have a lot of situations where I go, ooh, I shouldn't have got that, you know. Or I shouldn't have been able to get that in some, you know, but yeah, you can say privilege. I've gone in through my life. I think I've experienced a lot of situations differently from other people. And in my book, How High the Moon, the novel that I mentioned before, I actually deal with colorism in both directions. I mean, I deal with it. Oh. Her cousin, the girl, yeah, the main character is light skinned and isn't sure if her, doesn't know who her father is, and doesn't know if he's possibly white and what that means growing up in the segregated South.
Yeah.
But she lives with her black cousin's grandparents, and her mother is black. Mm-hmm. And she and her cousin Myrna, who's brown skinned, gets, you know, we get to see how people treat the main character, Ella. She gets treated a little bit different from some people. Some of the white people treat her a little bit differently. And I grew up seeing that. I grew up seeing people treat me. But I had, you know, I had both experiences. It's so strange. I grew up, I remember in when I went to junior high school or middle school, they call it now. I remember when I went and there was a group of girls, of black girls, who hated me. And were always like, they were threatening to kick my ass after school because of how I looked. They didn't know me. They hadn't spoken with me.
Exactly.
They said I was, immediately I was conceited. They hated me. She thinks she's so this and that. And I went through that. And they were threatening to kick my ass after school. And the only reason it didn't happen is because there was another group of girls, black girls, who were like, oh, she's so cute. She's so adorable. And they put me under their wing and they loved me so much. But also based on how I looked, it was either both groups, the ones that hated me and the ones that loved me, both groups were actually I got to know people later, but when I first showed up, people were judging me completely from, you know, whether they either hated me or they loved me based on just the way I appeared and what that meant to them. So, you know, I'm happy to see that we are seeing so many incredible talents out there, all colors now. We're starting to see finally, not just a few here and there, but a lot of people, you know, with more melanin out there representing. And I think that is hugely important. And also, as you can attest to, you know, invaluable to hear that, because to think that somebody said that to you, that you were told that, is a crime. I mean, to me, that's a crime that somebody would dare to say something like that. And I just hope that person's watching you now and is like, oh, durr.
You know, I'm so obsessed with like hair and makeup. And something that I've always wanted to ask you is, in the later seasons of The Fresh Prince, you had really straight hair. Because you always had curly hair. So I was wondering, was straightening your hair your choice, or were you told by producers that Hilary Banks needs to have straight hair?
I think we wanted to change it up, but it was certainly not the producers. Actually in the first season, I opted for my hair to be straight in an episode because at the time I thought, I was like, you know, Hilary would be, she'd have her hair straight. She'd be trying to look like, you know, Ivanka Trump. She'd be doing Ivana at the time. Ivanka was a kid. She was trying to look like Ivana Trump. You know, all kinds of, you know, this whole what would be what she would look at. And so I had her hair, I had them straighten her hair for an episode. And Andy and Susan Borowitz, the creators of the show, came running up to me after the show was over and they said, don't ever do that again. They said, we didn't know who you were. You came on this shot. We were all frantically looking to try to figure out who, they didn't recognize me at all. And they didn't know what was going on. They're like, don't ever do that again. And they always loved my hair curly. They never had any problem with it. I didn't have a problem with it. I mean, I'm fortunate, I have to say, that because of the way I grew up and where I grew up, and my mom, I guess, my mom had a big afro when I was a kid. And I just thought my mom was like the most beautiful goddess in the world. Yeah, and so I was always like looking up to looking like her. She looked like Cleopatra Jones, you know, she was like Tamara Dobson, this tall, round skin woman with huge afro. And so I think a part of me was always kind of emulating her, even into adulthood. I think a little part of me is always, that was my idea of beauty, right? And so I never felt funny with my hair curly. I was always kind of, it was always that way. Whenever I did have it straight, for the most part, I didn't like how I looked. Plus, I like to get my hair wet. Like if it's raining, I want to have it rain. If I, you know, I want to jump swimming. In the pool. Yeah, I don't want to have to like my hair can't because of my hair. You know, my hair would frizz up like this anyway. So, so it was never really much. It was always kind of curly, and it was great because I didn't feel badly about it. The producers didn't. They actually were championing it. They wanted it that way.
I love that.
So that was just later on when you saw it straight. That was just changing it up. That was just because, like,
okay,
you know, let's change her hair up for a minute. Plus, they were wigs. I was wearing wigs then. When you see it straight, those are wigs.
What?
Because my hair was getting fried from having to be, you know, then touch up the curls and do stuff all the time. Or if I did a movie over the summer and they curled it every single day. So the wigs was also a protective idea.
Those were good lace wigs then.
Oh, I'm glad. They weren't great. They weren't great. Carol McCoo, our hair person, was really, she knew how to, you know, do it right.
You know, just recently, the trailer for the new Fresh Prince of Bel-Air just came out on YouTube and it did phenomenal with the views. So I was wondering, have you seen the new trailer? What's your opinion about that? And how do you feel about the new Hillary Banks? What's your opinion on the new Hillary?
No, I've seen the pilot and I think they did a great job.
Okay.
You know, I'm really excited for and happy for Will, and I wish him the absolute best. And we'll see. It's a totally different, you know, what they're going for is entirely different. It's a drama. It is not comedy.
Yeah. It's a little darker.
Yeah, so we'll see what it brings and how people.
Well, what do you think of Hillary, the new Hillary? What do you think?
I've met Coco, and she's very sweet, and I'm excited for her. Coco is actually more like Hillary in real life.
No way.
You know what I mean? She's more like a Hillary. She's very like social media conscious, and she's got her. You know, she knows her, she's very Hillary, and she says so herself. And I was never as much Hillary as I found the character and discovered and created this character. And that's how I came to know her and own her, it's different, a different relationship to it. But I'm very curious to hear where it goes. And
yeah, me too. You know, nowadays social media has taken over everything. So if social media was around back in the days, which apps and which websites do you think that Hillary Banks would be dominating right now? What would be her favorite?
Oh, back then. I mean, I think she'd just be ruling it for sure. She probably
sure.
I think she would have been the inventor of the selfie. I think that would have come from her. That would have originated right there.
True. I have to bring up the reunion, because you guys, all of you from the Fresh Prince, reunited, and I'm so glad that you did this, because it was just so beautiful to see you all come back together, and it was so emotional, especially with the James Avery tribute. I want to know, how did you feel doing the reunion and coming back again on the set that was built exactly how it was back in the day? Like, what was that like for you to go back on set and to see everything, you know what I mean? Like, just as it was before, it was, because for me and for so many other fans, it was so highly emotional, but I would like to know how you were feeling in that moment.
It was a roller coaster of emotions, that's for sure. I knew it was going to be emotional, but I didn't know it was going to be quite as emotional as it was. You know, they had us meet on, they recreated the set, which was really mind-blowing, and it brought up all kinds of stuff, and it felt so strange, and they kept us all separate, so we didn't see each other until we walked onto the set. And they had, you know, we had to get our makeup and hair done and our wardrobe. So it was like we were preparing for a show, like we all used to prepare for a show. And then we all walked onto the set together and saw each other. So it was very emotionally charged. We were all, you know, everyone was really a little more raw than we expected to be. Mm-hmm. And it was really beautiful. And I think it took me about 2 weeks to come down from.
Now, the last question that I always love to ask my interviewees is to finish the sentence. So today, Karyn Parsons is?
Oh gosh, today I am grateful, honored.